So all set, should we start?
Yes.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 13J, which is Pathology of Head and Neck. And we are streaming live from AIIMS New Delhi via Kolkata. Yet another very interesting topic, making sense of perplexing fibro-osseous jaw lesion, a case-based approach by none other than the famous Dr. Deepika Mishra. She's a master and an expert in head and neck and oral pathology. She's an MDS in oral pathology and microbiology. Presently, she's an associate professor, Department of Oral Pathology and Microbiology, Center of Dental Education and Research, AIIMS New Delhi, which is also the WHO Collaborating Center for Oral Health Promotion, National Center of Excellence for Implementation of National Oral Health Program. She has been instrumental in starting the Oral Pathology and Microbiology Department at Center for Dental Education and Research, AIIMS, initiated oral cytopathology and histopathology services at the center. She's also instrumental in having the research projects in collaboration with other departments at AIIMS, namely the IIT Delhi, CSR, IGIB Delhi. Also involved as a resource person to train people for oral cancer screening with National Health System Resource Center and ICMR, National Institute for Cytology and Preventive Oncology, Noida. She also initiated oral pathology clinic at CDER AIIMS. She's also instrumental in preparation of MOOC modules on oral cancer at primary healthcare levels for WHO regional guidance for Southeast Asia region. She's got more than 40 publications in national and international peer-reviewed journals with 4 published book chapters. An area of interest in both is bone pathology, oral and maxillofacial region, osteogenic cysts and tumors, diagnostics in oral cancers and oral potentially malignant disorder. Before I ask Dr. Mishra to start, let me request all of you, please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let's not waste any time. Let's ask Madam, please share your screen and let's start. Thank you so much.
Yeah, very good evening, and thank you so much, Dr. Nadeem, for your very kind words and very nice introduction. Without further ado, we'll start with our next session, which is making sense of perplexing fibro-osseous jaw lesions, a case-based approach. To begin, you know, these fibro-osseous lesions have been very close to my heart because I would say not just few, but almost all of these fibro-osseous lesions are perplexing, because sometimes, you know, we can really get confused, and sometimes when we are not provided with the radiology and we have to do some sort of guesswork, it's like really challenging and it really keeps you on your toes. So these are the lesions. Once we, whenever we get this kind of case, we have to just prepare our residents or ourselves that you have to do a lot of running in terms of getting the radiology, the opinion from the radiologist, the clinical opinion. So these cases has to be taken quite seriously, and they're quite challenging once you, you know, sort of crack the diagnosis for these cases. This is maybe because of the COVID, I would say we were getting less of, you know, crowd. So, and there's because of the lockdown, I would say we were fortunate to get a clear sky at our institute. So this is just a morning pic we took, and of course it's a very nice weather today in Delhi. So to begin, I would say, I would just quote a famous saying by Ralph Green. If you can make the diagnosis, the treatment is easy and the damage can be reversed. But making the diagnosis is tricky. So this really stands true for these fibrosis lesions, which we'll be discussing today. The fibrosis lesions of the craniofacial skeleton, it basically comprises the intraosseous disease processes that share similar microscopic, clinical, as well as the radiological features. And they, as the term says, fibrosis, they're basically characterized by hypercellular fibroblastic stroma containing various calcified structures. So some of these entities are diagnosable histologically, so they are like a spot diagnosis, but most of these lesions, they require a combined approach. These can comprise of reactive lesions, sometimes neoplastic lesions, the developmental, and as well as dysplastic lesions. So basically we have to combine all the three approaches to arrive at a diagnosis. Fibrosis lesions have been classified from as late as 1985 by Sir Waldron, and they have been, you know, reclassified till date, and you know, till 2017 they are there are a lot of changes which keeps happening with these entities. So in 1985, Charles Waldron gave the first classification of fibrosis lesions of the jaws, following which there has been a lot of modifications done by Dr. Malik, then Dr. Slutwig. In WHO, in 1992, these entities have been introduced, followed by again certain modifications in 2005, and in 2017, again there has been some terminology changes in these classifications. So in 1985, Charles Waldron gave fibrous dysplasia. They introduced fibrous dysplasia as monostotic and polyostotic into these fibrosis lesions, these entities. Second category they created was the fibrosis lesions, mainly the cemental lesions, presumably because they arise in the periodontal ligament, in which they have subcategorized periapical cemental dysplasia, localized fibrosis cemental lesions, probably reactive in nature, florid cementosious dysplasia, ossifying and cementifying fibroma. The third component they kept as the fibrosis neoplasms of uncertain or detectable relationship to those arising in the periodontal ligament. It comprised of cementoblastoma, osteoblastoma, and osteoid osteoma, juvenile active ossifying fibroma, and other so-called aggressive active ossifying and cementifying fibromas. In 1992, the WHO gave the concept that the cementum-like tissues in lesions in extragnathic sites suggested that these may be normal variant of bone. So in WHO's classification in 1992, three of the cemental lesions were transferred to the neoplasm and other groups related to bone. So that is the group which they have transferred, leaving the benign cementoblastoma as the sole true neoplasm of the dental cementum. So they have categorized as the osteogenic neoplasms, wherein they have just kept cemento-ossifying fibroma. And the other category they created as non-neoplastic bone lesions, wherein they included fibrous dysplasia, cemento-osseous dysplasia, cherubism, central giant cell granuloma, aneurysmal bone cyst, and solitary bone cyst. In 2005, cemento-osseous dysplasia has been transferred, and they started calling it as osseous dysplasia, and they gave up the term cement for the same reason that they have origin from periodontal ligament. They also additionally gave the concept that clinical pathological entities in which the diagnosis can only be made, they have included these fibrosis lesions in to those clinical pathological entities in which the diagnosis can only be made on the basis of and full consideration of clinical, histological, as well as radiological features. So with that as a base, that they have also recommended that the pathologist should give a sign out a diagnosis of fibrosis lesions after considering all the three approaches. They have now, because they gave up the term, so now they have changed it to again ossifying fibromas and osseous dysplasia. So they have completely removed the cementum. In 2017, again, the prefix cemento has been added. I know it's quite a comical thing which is happening, but that's how the classifications keeps changing with the evolution of the evidence. So they have added cemento to the variant, which is confined to the jaws. So now they have categorized ossifying fibroma into cemento ossifying fibroma, as well as the other variant is juvenile ossifying fibroma, which contains trabecular as well as cemomatoid. They have introduced a new entity separately as a familial gigantiform cementoma, which is still because of the fewer cases being reported. So there's been a lot of emphasis on this new entity. Fibrous dysplasia, they have categorized into monostotic, polyostotic and craniofacial types. And cemento-osseous dysplasia as periapical, focal and florid types. So starting with our case, first case. This is a 17-year-old male with a swelling in the lower jaw for past 1.5 years. The swelling was round, well-defined lytic lesion, showing some sclerotic changes with a ground glass appearance, and as well as there were areas with some low density. Patient additionally also had some skeletal lesions. When we did certain tests, we found that the patient had insufficient vitamin D levels, as well as high growth hormone and high alkaline phosphatase levels. Patient had 7 siblings, and except one sister, all had some skeletal deformity. Additionally, his father also he's passed away, and he also had a history of femur fracture. His sister also had a jaw swelling, which is very similar to this to our present case. Grossly, we received the specimen, which was multiple whitish firm tissues, and they were gritty on cut surface. When we saw the histology, the tissue comprised the specimen mainly comprised of the fibroblastic hypercellular stroma, a lot of proliferating spindle and round shape, mimicking maybe a fibroblast. Then there were a lot of basophilic calcifications, which were resembling cementicles, also called as, like, they were resembling as cemoma bodies. The high magnification showed that most of them were lined by osteoblasts. And all these fibroblasts, they were plump, they were quite active, and with a lot of vasculature. But there was no marked ATPI, which could be seen in the entire specimen. There were a few areas of osteoid formation in varying shapes and was undergoing calcification at various areas. They were also exhibiting some brushed border-like appearance in few areas. We could appreciate the osteoblastic rimming around the osteoid, which has been laid down, and there was a calcification which was also taking at the which was also occurring in the same osteoid areas. There were a few more calcification with encasement of some osteocytes within them. So we formed a differential diagnosis of considering it as a because of the site, we considered cemento-osseous fibroma as a first differential. Considering the age of the patient, we kept juvenile cemomatoid and trabecular ossifying fibroma, and also because it showed some sort of ground glass appearance, though it was well defined, we have kept like a vague diagnosis of fibrous dysplasia, and of course there were multiple sites which were involved, so we were considering polyostotic type could be one of the differential. So just going to what we already have, with what all cases we have already seen. So based on our experience with those cases, we sort of started evaluating this particular case and started comparing it with the cases we have reported and also the literature, whatever has been reported so far. So coming to the first differential, the cemento-ossifying fibroma, which are confined to the tooth-bearing areas, mainly predominantly mandible, more predominant directly in mandible, then maxilla. The neoplastic cells elaborate bone and cementum and are considered to be derived from progenitor cells of the periodontal ligament. They can attain a very large size with considerable deformity if untreated, and are mostly seen in third to fourth decades with a female predilection. So this is also one of our case with a 44-year-old female who had a swelling in the right posterior mandibular region. When we saw the histology, these cases are mostly encapsulated and show a hypercellular fibroblastic stroma. They have a hyperchromatic nuclei with no marked ATP in most of the cases. And the osteoid or bone is mostly surrounding these basophilic calcifications or these lobulated basophilic masses, which resemble cementum-like tissue. Now, these structures may collise and form curvilinear trabeculae, which may be acellular. They mostly have osteoblastic rimming around the bony trabeculae. Coming to our second differential, juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma. These cases are mostly unencapsulated but have a well-delineated border. They have a loose architecture. The hypercellular stroma is composed mainly of the spindle cells with little collagen production. They show mostly a long, slender strands that have been likened to have a paintbrush-like pattern. Now, they are mostly they are devoid of osteoblastic rimming because they show no evidence of maturation. They are quite aggressive in nature. There could be aggregates of osteoclastic giant cells, and very occasionally mitosis could also be seen in these cases. Coming to the semomatoid type, they show more of a semoma bodies. They are also unencapsulated, quite aggressive, and they show predominantly of multiple small uniform ossicles or semomatoid bodies. They are basophilic, and at the periphery of these the lesion, these structures may collise and form bony trabeculae. Sometimes these lesions can also show cystic degeneration, and that can also, the pathologist should keep it in mind that could be a sign of a secondary aneurysmal bone cyst in these entities. Coming to the next differential of fibrous dysplasia, they are mostly bland fibroblastics. They are comprised mostly of bland fibroblastic cells. Mitosis is very uncommon in these cases. They are irregular shaped trabeculae of immature, and I would say in jaw lesions we see a lot of mature bone as well, without mostly osteoblastic rimming. Now, the trabeculae often assume curvilinear forms, which gives it a name of Chinese characters in appearance. Now, the lesional bone fuses with the normal adjacent bone. That's one of the reasons why they do not have a well-defined border, rather they blend with the normal bone. So even in radiographs, they have a blending border rather than a well-defined, as seen in ossifying fibromas. Now, unlike fibrous dysplasia and long bones, craniofacial lesions may undergo progressive maturation to lamellar bone. And also in the jaw lesions, we have seen that focally they can show sometimes osteoblastic rimming. So just combining all the features of this patient was a young age with no associated hormone derangement. Radiographically was a well-demarcated margins. Intraoperatively also the surgical notes and the clinicians revealed that it had a well-circumscribed boundaries. Macroscopically we saw that the tissue was firm with tan cut surface. And microscopically, we saw hypercellular stroma with some calcifications of predominantly of semomatoid with few trabecular concentric pattern and osteoblastic rimming of the bone trabeculae. So I'm sure we all would agree that it's a juvenile semomatoid ossifying fibroma. But that is not the end of the story. So now the clinical pathological findings, the patient had multiple lesions. They had multiple lesions. There were some skeletal lesions as well. Then they had the siblings which were involved having similar lesions. The patient was of a young age, less than 18 years. So we went to the literature and we actually found that the multiple ossifying fibromas are quite rare. And there have been few case reports wherein they have seen that two cases with a sporadic multiple ossifying fibroma has been reported with no genetic NAS1 and HRPT2 mutations. NAS is the mutation which is mostly seen in fibrous dysplasias. And HRPT2 gene mutation is mostly seen in multiple ossifying fibromas associated with hyperparathyroidism, jaw lesion syndrome. Now, in these two cases, the first case has three lesions, whereas the case second case had four lesions involving maxilla and mandible. In total, 18 cases have been reported so far of sporadic multiple ossifying fibromas, and 24 cases of hyperparathyroidism-related jaw tumor syndrome has been reported. Now, coming to the familial, because we know that there were multiple people who have been involved in our present case, we saw that there was one case with familial multiple ossifying fibromas, where the daughter and the mother reported with lesion, when daughter had multiple lesions. And there was another case report wherein, again, the familial multiple ossifying fibromas has been reported in father and daughter. So again, coming back to the same thing, that for multiple lesions, I would say that 18 cases has been reported, but they are all sporadic. Juvenile, yes, because our case was less than 18 years, and two cases of familial has been reported so far. So with that, we signed it out as familial multiple ossifying fibroma, and this is the third reported case in the literature so far. Now, just talking about the very classic, these ossifying juvenile ossifying fibromas. Now, this is a six-year-old male who had a swelling in the expansile lesion in the right maxilla, which was fairly well demarcated with cortical thinning and possible perforation in few areas. Histology actually revealed it was unencapsulated with well-delineated border, and there were irregular strands of osteoid with varying degree of calcifications and closing the osteocytes. There was loose architecture with hypercellular stroma composed of spindle cells with little collagen production. As we go to the hyper, we could appreciate that there has been a calcification which is occurring in the osteoid matrix, and there was a sort of osteoblastic rimming in few areas. So this is a classic of juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma. Just how to differentiate these two entities: the cemento ossifying fibromas are the ossifying fibromas of olentogenic origin, and they are also termed as ossifying fibromas earlier, or cementifying fibromas. Central ossifying fibromas are periodontoma, so these are all the synonyms. Whereas the juvenile ossifying is now by WHO being divided into juvenile trabecular and cemomatoid. Juvenile ossifying fibromas, how we differentiate between trabecular and cemomatoid. If we talk about the clinical, trabecular is the rare bone tumor, and the mean age is less than the ones which we see in the juvenile cemomatoid type. So they are the ones which are mainly seen in 8.5 to 12 years of age, whereas the cemomatoid is mostly seen in adolescents, somewhere around 16 to 30 years of age. There's no gender predilection in both of them. And juvenile trabecular is the one which is mostly reported in jaws, with the predilection in maxilla. And they are rarely reported in extragnathic sites, whereas the cemomatoid is the one which is reported mainly in extragnathic, but can be reported in jaws also. But they are the ones which mainly involves periorbital, frontal, or ethmoid bones, the craniofacial bones. Both of them have a rapid expansion. They can cause bony expansion. And when the trabecular type, because it involves mainly jaws, predominantly maxilla, so they can lead to nasal obstruction or epistaxis. Whereas the cemomatoid, because it involves the extragnathic bones, they can involve orbit, nasal bone, sinuses, leading to proptosis, visual symptoms, or nasal obstruction in the patient. Radiographically, if we say, both of them are well demarcated. They present as radiolucent, may show various degrees of opacification. We always have to keep it in mind that sometimes these lesions can show rapid tumor growth, which are caused by secondary aneurysmal bone cyst formation. When we talk about treatment and prognosis among all the three, cemento ossifying fibromas are mostly slow-growing benign neoplasms, and surgically, they're mostly excised by curettage or enucleation with no recurrences in most cases. The untreated tumors can attain a massive size and may require in-block resection, So of course, they do require a treatment, and the malignant transformation is not reported in any or three of them. If you talk about the trabecular and semi-motoid type, they can show multiple recurrences that has been reported following conservative excision. So if we talk about recurrence, their chances of showing recurrence is more than cemento ossifying. So that's why the diagnosis becomes really important, whether it's a juvenile type or a cemento ossifying fibroma type. Whereas if we talk about malignant transformation, none of these three entities there has been a malignant transformation has been reported as to my knowledge till now. Now, when we compare our cemento ossifying fibroma with fibrous dysplasias, now cemento ossifying fibromas, they are mostly well-defined lesions which can be shelled out or curated from the surrounding bone with relative ease. So even surgical notes or a talk with a surgeon can tell you how exactly the lesion felt when they were excising or sending you the biopsy. Whereas the fibrous dysplasia is the one which has ill-defined borders that blend with the surrounding bones, so which could be appreciated even in radiology, as well as even the surgeons can tell you when they take a biopsy. Now, cemento ossifying fibromas are the ones which are predominantly seen in females in third to fourth decades. Whereas the fibrous dysplasia, it can affect any part of the craniofacial skeleton and predominantly seen in children and young adults. So the age group slightly matches or overlaps with the juvenile variants. There have been a lot of genetic studies which have been done, and multiple ossifying fibromas have been found to be associated with hyperparathyroidism, jaw tumor, familial cancer syndrome, wherein mutations of CDC73 or HRPT2 tumor suppressor gene has been found. And they have found that it has been linked to a parafibromin protein, which is a product of HRPT2, that is believed to be involved in the cell cycle regulation by interfering with cyclin D1. These HRPT2 or I would say the hyperparathyroidism, jaw tumor, familial cancer syndrome, it lacks NAS1 gene mutation, which is a characteristic feature of fibrous dysplasias. So many of the times when we feel that, okay, it's a multiple ossifying fibroma, and we sort of confuse it with polyostotic type of fibrous dysplasia wherein multiple sites could be involved, therein this NAS1 gene mutation can be really very helpful. Now, this is one of the very landmark papers from modern pathology, wherein they have compared ossifying fibromas with fibrous dysplasias based on molecular and immunological characterization. I would say it was really a very important paper, because sometimes these entities could be really challenging, wherein the radiology and even histology can overlaps with each other. And they have stated in this paper that fibrous dysplasias and ossifying fibromas, they're similar disease entities, especially in the demonstration of osteogenic lineage in stromal fibroblast-like cells. They show distinct differences that can be revealed by IHC detection of osteocalcin expression. The PCR analysis for NAS mutation is a useful method to differentiate between fibrous dysplasia and ossifying fibroma. Sometimes these ossifying fibromas, they can be associated with rare systemic genetic disorders, or they could be manifestations of systemic genetic disorders. So though they are rare, but and they are not very well defined conditions, so we need to be very careful if we see some suspicious case of ossifying fibromas multiple. So we need to rule out any other systemic genetic disorder as well. So it could be hyperparathyroidism, jaw tumor syndrome, as I told. There could be association with familial gigantiform cementomas or fragile bone syndrome with fibrosis jaw lesions. The one which we have most talked about is hyperparathyroidism, jaw tumor syndrome. It's basically the primary hyperparathyroidism is seen in these cases with multiple parathyroid adenomas at an early age. These syndromic patients have an increased risk for parathyroid carcinoma and fibrosis jaw lesions and renal cyst or tumors. The jaw lesions in these syndromes are mostly seen in mandible then maxilla. Mostly they are bilateral and they affect tooth-bearing areas. Radiographically, they can show expansile lytic lesions, radiolucent with mixed, sometimes radiopacities, and they almost always show mutations in HRPT2 gene. Coming to our next case, is a 40-year-old male who presented with a diffuse hard bony swelling in the maxilla. So if we see in the orthopentomogram, there was a ground glass appearance with indistinct borders in the left maxilla, which was blending with the surrounding involved bone. Histopathologically, they had a rubbery, compressible and gritty texture when cutting, and they had an irregular, mature, curvilinear shaped bony trabeculae without any osteoblastic rimming in most of the areas, and it was undergoing maturation in few areas and showed peripheral split of the stroma. This happens because of the different consistency, so these are the artifacts which gets created during sectioning. Now the stroma showed was moderately cellular with loose to dense fibrocollagenous in nature. There was also focally osteoblastic rimming which was seen around these bony trabeculae in few areas. So it was a classic case of a fibrous dysplasia. In fibrous dysplasia, a normal bone is actually distorted and replaced by poorly organized and inadequately mineralized immature bone and fibrous tissue. There could be monostotic type wherein only a single bone is involved, or polyostotic type wherein multiple bones could be involved. And one such syndrome is the McEwen-Albright syndrome with skin pigmentations and endocrinopathies. The third type could be craniofacial fibrous dysplasia wherein multiple adjacent craniofacial bones could be involved. Now, depending on at what stage the mutation in NAS1 gene occurs, can define whether it could be a monostotic type involving just single bone, or a polyostotic type involving multiple organs, or just a craniofacial type. So at what stage the NAS mutation occurs is a defining factor. Clinically, these features, these fibrous dysplasias comprise of 7% of all benign bone tumors. Mostly, they are seen in children and adolescents. More than 80% cases are reported in them. They can involve craniofacial bones and also femur. Maxilla is the predominant site. It may involve adjacent bones as well. They are mostly cause painless swelling, and can involve paranasal sinuses, orbits, foramina of the skull, which can lead to respective signs like headache, visual loss, nasal obstruction, and hearing loss. So this is just to show you how classic ground glass appearance with indistinct borders these fibrous dysplasias can present to, and they blend imperceptibly with the surrounding involved bone. Sometimes they can also cause narrowing of the periodontal ligament spaces and effacement of lamina dura. Now histologically, depends on disease stage, there could be bland fibroblastic cells and mitosis is very uncommon. They can show immature woven bone without osteoblastic rimming. They can show curvilinear pattern which resemble Chinese characters, and may undergo maturation to lamellar bone, which is unlike fibrous dysplasia and long bones. Now coming to the treatment and prognosis, these lesions stabilize with maturation. Surgical intervention in younger patients should be delayed, and simple contouring of the facial or skull bones is recommended. Now, very rarely malignant transformation occurs in these entities. So, and majority such cases has been seen had a history of radiation therapy. So that's one of the reason why radiation therapy for fibrous dysplasia is now strictly contraindicated. Because of the same reason of rarely showing a malignant transformation, they are kept for long-term follow-up. And any patient showing clinical or radiographic evidence of change should undergo a biopsy to rule out any sarcomatous transformation. Now coming to our next case is a 29-year-old male or 29-year-old female presenting a radiolucent lesion in the left mandible with respect to second molar. And if we see, there was a small radiopaque nidus in between in the center. It's a very well-defined lesion. But if we also focus, the tooth looks like a vital tooth and do not show any caries, though it's just a two-dimensional radiograph. When we saw the histology, we saw it was a fibrocellular stroma very loosely collagenous stroma. I would not say very highly cellular, but yes, loosely collagenous stroma. And there were some basophilic calcifications, as well as some osteoid formation in between, with few osteoblastic rimming in few areas. The trabeculae pattern were quite thick in appearance. As you go to the high power, the fibroblasts, they were mostly spindle-shaped fibroblasts with some deposition of osteoid and woven bone. There was few globular cementum-like deposits as well. So the differentials, of course, considering that, yes, the inflammatory associated, whenever it's associated with the tooth, we should keep inflammatory as a first etiology, though we can rule out in this present case because tooth looked vital. But yes, even radicular cyst or even Gary's osteomyelitis are long-standing. Radicular cysts are mostly radiolucent, but if you talk about a long-standing ones, when it leads to osteomyelitis or Gary's osteomyelitis, can sometimes mimic these entities. Now, sometimes neoplastic lesions can present as, you know, some radiolucent lesion in the jaw, but they're mostly associated with pain or expansion of the jaws. So definitely we rule that out as well based on the clinical features. Jaw metastasis can also mainly from the breast and prostate carcinoma, or even for example renal cell carcinoma, they can metastasize to jaws and can present as radiolucent lesions, but they are usually associated with pain, looseness of teeth or paresthesia of the lip. So none of those features would rule this diagnosis also. Coming to the fibrous dysplasia, they should have, the bony trabeculars are mostly thinner as compared to the one which we saw in our histology. They were more of a ginger root-like pattern and more thicker in appearance. As well as the radiology, fibrous dysplasia, as we already discussed, have a blending pattern, whereas this was a well-defined pattern which we saw. Ossifying fibroma, now if you talk about histology, this particular histology was not so, it was not so highly cellular to call it as an ossifying fibroma. It didn't look like an aggressive lesion. Now we are left with the last one, the cementoosseous dysplasia. So I think so we are left with the, you know, it's of course a diagnosis also of exclusion in this present case. But then these are the entities which are non-neoplastic fibroosseous lesions that affect the tooth-bearing areas of the jaws. They are mostly asymptomatic and usually discovered on routine dental radiographs and are associated with vital teeth. So that those are the features which, you know, sort of throw a light towards cementoosseous dysplasias. Many of the times they actually do not require even any surgical intervention or even a biopsy. But such cases which is like a present case wherein we need to rule out other causes, we need to, you know, we need to go for a biopsy for those particular cases. Now, three variants exist for these cementoosseous dysplasias on the basis of anatomical location. One could be one such case was a periapical cementoosseous dysplasia. So, if you see in this particular case, we saw there was a radiolucent lesion associated with again mandibular anterior tooth. Now, these periapical cementoosseous dysplasias are the ones which are mostly, you know, would come, would be excised and would come to pathology services. They are the ones which are mostly associated with apical areas of mandibular anterior teeth. They are asymptomatic, so the patient would have a history of, you know, it would be an accidentally they would have discovered this particular entity. They have a well-defined clinical radiological features. Predominantly, they are associated with vital mandibular incisors. Focal cementoosseous dysplasia are the ones which are associated again with single tooth. They are mostly associated with tooth-bearing areas, especially in the posterior jaws, unlike the periapical ones which are seen in anteriors, whereas the focal ones are mostly seen in posterior jaws, particularly in sites of former extraction. Now, the floric type, this is also one of our case wherein she's a 70-year-old female who actually came for a rehabilitation of her missing teeth, wherein it was an accidental finding that she had a case of a florid cementitious dysplasias. So they are multifocal. They are identified clinically and radiographically without the need of for a biopsy. A surgical intervention is contraindicated and can result in persistent local infection and pain. Now, the treatment, ideally, cementitious dysplasias should be identified clinically and radiographically and not subjected to surgical intervention. There could be certain other differentials or other mimics which I would say can mimic fibrosis entities, and few of the authors have actually included them under fibrosis lesions also. The first one, I would try to talk about the inflammatory or reactive processes, because they are the ones which are most commonly encountered in any of the pathology services. Now, this is, as we see that this case showed just some degenerated bony trabeculae with empty lacunae and some stromal cores. So I know these are very easy to diagnose and everybody can diagnose them as osteomyelitis. So these days, I think so these entities have become really very important, especially because we keep hearing about the mucormycosis. So we have seen a lot of cases wherein osteomyelitis has been found associated with mucormycosis as a secondary feature. Now, these osteomyelitis, they are most infections of the jaws. Most infections of the jaws are actually odontogenic in origin, which is basically responsible of making osteomyelitis as one of the common entity which we'll encounter in our services. Now, pyogenic and anaerobic bacteria, they are usually responsible for acute, subacute or chronic osteomyelitis. Intraoral as well as cutaneous sinus tracts could also be seen in these particular conditions. Radiographically, they mostly present as moth-eaten radiolucencies owing to the osteoclastic resorption, which is induced by the infectious agents and host inflammatory response. Now, sometimes low-grade infections, which usually occur in the mandible, may initiate osteoblastic rather than osteoclastic activity. So that is also one of the reasons why they can sometimes mimic fibrosis lesions. This is a case of a focal sclerosing osteomyelitis, or we also can call it as a condensing osteitis. Now, they can present as they are the mildest and most self-limited form, mostly seen in the posterior mandible at apices of the molar teeth. They're mostly asymptomatic and non-expansile periapical lesion, which are associated with the tooth exhibiting deep caries. Radiographically, they present, the early cases, they can present as a radiolucency at the apex, and they can progress to focal opacification at the root apex, which is also known as reactive osteogenesis. Now, histopathologically, most of the early cases, they definitely present with inflammation, but sometimes there is no inflammation also could be encountered, and that is the time when they can mimic a benign fibrosis lesion. Now, paralleling of the trabeculae do occur in the proliferative periostitis conditions, whereas in the late conditions, a dense osteosclerosis occurs and diffuse sclerosing osteomyelitis. Treatment is mostly root canal treatment or endodontic therapy. Yet the apical radiopacities, they fail to resolve even after the treatment, so we should really not bother. Now, the differentials which should be included for osteomyelitis other than focal cementitious dysplasias could be focal osteosclerosis or even a bone scar associated with the non-carious tooth. So those are the conditions wherein no surgical intervention or a biopsy is also required. Diffuse sclerosing osteomyelitis, these entities, they are basically the cortical osseous expansion occurs in these cases, and these patients give a history of dull episodic pain that may last for weeks only to subside and later become symptomatic again. They can be associated with grossly carious tooth overlying the region. Radiographically, they present with unilateral diffuse ground glass opacification without defined boundaries of the mandibular body. Histologically, they could be microscopically, they can show a fibrosis pattern with intervening foci of dense sclerotic bone, and the osseous elements can sometimes mimic trabecular pattern. Differentials could be fibrous dysplasia or florid cementitious dysplasias. Now coming to a case of a 70-year-old female with a pathological fracture of right mandible. She gave a history of bisphosphonate-related medication and rheumatoid arthritis. The histology showed mostly the acellular necrotic bony tubercle with empty lacunae in most of the areas. And there were a few of the reactive tubercle with some osteocytes and suggesting of some viable bone. And there could be some focal detachment of multinucleated osteoclastic giant cells with some mixed inflammation. So based on the clinical as well as the histology and the radiology, we signed it out as a medication-related osteonecrosis of jaws. So those are the entities which also, go back and take the history of the patient and look for any medications which patient is undergoing. Coming to our next case is a 37-year-old lady who presented with a multilocular lesions in bilateral mandible. So both the sides, right and left mandibles, were involved. Then there was also lesion in the clevis region. So they had three lesions. Now the left and right mandibular lesions, as well as the clevis region, we consulted with a pathologist as well as we reviewed all the slides of all the three entities, and we saw that these cases, all three of them showed a mixed pattern with the fibrocellular stroma intermixed with numerous multinucleated giant cells, and there were also some bony tubercle in adjacent areas with some fibrocellular stroma around them. When we went to the hyper, there were again a moderately cellular stroma with some active multinucleated giant cells, and there was some osteoid formation in the form of, you know, tubercle in few areas, and there was some osteoblastic rimming which was evident in few places. So there were multiple lesions in the mandible as well as clevis, and all of them showed a similar histopathology. So we made a differential. The first one was Brown's tumor of hyperparathyroidism, considering that the multiple sites are involved. So something to do with the systemic condition. Aneurysmal bone cyst, considering there were some of the sinusoidal-like spaces in few areas. But of course, we could not explain multiple site involvement with aneurysmal bone cyst. We also thought in terms of hybrid lesion of ossifying fibroma and giant cell granuloma. Though, as we went back to the histology, the areas wherein the osteoblast or the osteoblastic rimming or the bony tubercle were seen were not quite suggestive of any aggressive, a neoplasm like a ossifying fibroma. So the tumor looks slightly more bland, more like a peripheral reactive bone formation, or maybe some entity which is sort of causing a sort of bone resorption rather than a active lesion. Then we also, because of the multiple site involvement, we also thought in terms of polyosteotic fibrous dysplasia, but again, they all, the lesions radiographically were well defined, and the histology was also not very supportive of fibrous dysplasia. We checked with the we investigated with the parathormone levels of the patient, we actually found that they all were high, though the serum calcium was normal. So we signed it out as a Brown's tumor of hyperparathyroidism. So whenever we see those multiple sites which could be involved and which are not fitting into any of these fibrosis entities, we also have to look into any giant cell lesions. And of course, these giant cell lesions can sometimes mimic our fibrosis lesions because they are also quite aggressive. And when they sort of invade, they can either mimic them or they can sometimes be associated with them. So we also need to consider those differentials as one of as whenever we are dealing with the fibrosis lesions. So coming to our next case is a 21-year-old female who presented with pain and swelling and loosening of the teeth on the mandible. And as we see, there was a mixed radiolucent and radiopaque with a cortical permeation periosteal reaction. When we saw the histology, there were a lot of osteoid formation with some encaspment of osteocytes within them. And if we see the cells, they were looking, they are mostly, they have a open face nuclei. They look quite vascular nuclei and looks like an active lesion. Though there could not be any mitosis, which we are a cytological ATPA, which we could appreciate. Few of the areas did show some sort of osteoblastic rimming. The lesion was highly fibrocellular with some areas showing osteoid, and some cells were showing slightly ATPA. But of course, we were not very convinced with the histological picture. So we sort of made our entire differential of osteoid osteoma, osteoblastoma, which can sometimes could be aggressive ones. Then juvenile type of ossifying fibroma, because our patient was young. We were also looking into osteosarcoma, maybe the low grade one. So we'll deal one by one with the entity. So we just look back into our archives and took out some of the osteoid osteomas which we have reported so far. So this was a 29-year-old male who complained of pain and swelling in lower front region of the jaw since 1 year. So they have a very typical nocturnal pain kind of history. The lesion was well defined, enhancing with a mixed density lytic lesion with cortical thinning and erosion in the anterior aspect of the left mandible associated with the lateral incisor and canine region. Though it could not be appreciated much in the OPG, so here the CECT really helps in these kind of cases. Histology, mostly of these entities, they show dense sclerotic bone comprising of irregular bony trabeculae. So they have more of a sclerosis background. They can show a lining of osteoblasts in few areas, and the stromal course, they show mostly the dilated blood vessels and have a loose stromal course. So osteoid osteomas are mostly benign bone forming tumor which arise from osteoblasts. They are less than 2 cm in size and has a limited growth potential. Would be seen in second and third decade in jaws. Has an equal predilection in males and females, and has a very characteristic nocturnal pain which is relieved by NSAIDs. They have a localized swelling and pain, and has a similar histopathology as osteoblastomas. So you really cannot differentiate them when it comes to histology. Radiographically, these lesions have well circumscribed radiolucency or nidus or radiopaque foci with sclerosis. Histologically, they can have a mineralized trabecular bone or osteoid with rimming and loose stroma with some dilated vessels, and they are mostly treated by excision and curettage. Coming to the osteoblastomas, they are quite rare in the oral cavity and the bones, in the jaws, and they are mostly more than 2 cm with a male predilection. Now, in contrary to osteoid osteoma, they are asymptomatic. And there could be some aggressive osteoblastomas which can be even more than 4 cm and could be seen even in, they're mostly seen in more than 30 years. So again, our entity was less than 30 years. And again, this was not very much mimicking our case. So, and very rare to be reported. So we sort of ruled that osteoblastoma as well as osteoid osteoma. Now, when we went to the osteoblastic osteosarcomas, mostly these osteosarcomas, and we are considering osteoblastic type because of the osteoid which we are seeing in our present case. In osteoblastic osteosarcomas, mostly the conventional types, they have a lot of malignant osteoid undergoing calcification in many areas with quite atypical osteoblasts surrounding them, and there would be increased mitosis. If we see their nucleocytoplasmic ratio could be really high, there could be atypical mitosis. So these mostly these osteoblastic osteosarcomas are not really very confusing. If you see a lot of mitosis, a lot of ATPA and pleomorphism, they are mostly go for osteoblastic osteosarcomas, though sometimes they could be difficult when few of the cases do not display a lot of osteoid. Also, luckily, the markers do help, and they show high Ki-67 proliferative index, and of course, SARD-B2, which is a marker for osteogenic lineage, is also positive when it comes to differentiating them from other entities when there is less of osteoid. So that actually sort of cancel all our differentials. So we again went back to our books and literature, and we got this again a very good paper, which I would say a very landmark study which has been done, and which they have proposed that MDM2 and CDK4 can distinguish low-grade osteosarcomas from benign mimics. So that is something which can really help us in this case. We went ahead and did MDM2 and CDK4, which was highly positive in our case. Of course, our case was also positive for SAD-B2 and BCL2. So we signed it out as a low-grade osteosarcomas. So these low-grade osteosarcomas can be sometimes quite challenging because it's really becomes really impossible to differentiate them from aggressive osteoblastomas or juvenile ossifying fibromas. So I think so there these two markers can really be a boon. Now mostly these low-grade osteosarcomas are seen in, it's the fourth most common site of origin is jaw bones, and these patients mostly have a prior radiotherapy or Paget's disease, though our case didn't have any of this history. They have slow-growing pain, and patients report with swelling and loosening of teeth. Radiographically, they could have mixed radiolucencies with some aggressive features like cortical permeation, periosteal reaction. And histologically can have mild to moderately cellular vesicles of spindle fibroblast-like cells with mild nuclear atypia and irregular anastomosing, long and thick osteoid, low mitosis, but still can cause sometimes cortical destructions and invasive growth. Now, these entities are important because they can progress to high-grade sarcomas. So sometimes these high-grade sarcomas can show de-differentiation. So few of the areas can show low-grade type of de-differentiation, and rest could be a high-grade type. So these MDM2 and CDK4 are mostly positive, so can be really helpful in these particular cases. Coming to our next case, she's a 11-year-old female who presented with a radiolucent and bony hard swelling in the anterior mandible for 1 year. When we saw the lesion, it was highly cellular and it was compactly arranged. There were within the compactly arranged stroma, which were comprising of a lobular arrangement of cells, so we could appreciate some lobular pattern. There were interspersed these sweeping fascicles of spindle-shaped cells in the background of abundantly collagenized stroma. There were a few areas which showed some sort of degenerated bony trabeculae, or it could be some invasion into the adjacent muscles. Sometimes they could be really difficult to distinguish whether they are just degenerated trabeculae or, you know, invading into the muscle, though we do look for some osteocytes. Then few of the areas showed some osteoclastic giant cells or multinucleated giant cells. Then there were some foci of myxoid changes. There were a lot of tumor cells which were showing spindled configuration with abundant cytoplasm with indistinct cell borders. So as I said initially, that there could be some of the osteoblastic osteosarcomas which can sometimes do not display much of osteoid, and you know, serial sampling or serial sectioning can really help in diagnosing those cases. So we were just keeping our fingers crossed for that. And this is something very different which we rarely encounter in our in jaws. So we made an entire differential of a juvenile ossifying fibroma considering the intraosseous location, but of course we could not appreciate any cemento-osseous material. We saw the histology, there were no frank cemental like or basophilic calcifications or any trabeculae, frank trabeculae or osteoid matrix. Then we kept central ontogenic fibroma also as one of the differential, but there were no ontogenic epithelial rests, and moreover, the stroma was quite aggressive compared to the ontogenic fibroma. Then we consider the entire list of spindle cell tumors, like the nerve sheath tumors, which can show plexiform architectural of fascicles or storiform pattern, which were not there in our case. We kept well-differentiated fibrosarcomas also as one of our differential, which are mostly more cellular and shows herringbone pattern with nuclear hyperchromatism and mitosis and sometimes and often necrosis. And none of those features, you know, we could not appreciate any hyperchromatism or increased mitosis or necrotic areas. As some of our cases with nodular fasciitis we have seen, but though they again show more of mitosis and they show characteristic microcystic changes with hypovascular areas which were completely lacking, and they lack the sweeping fascicular pattern which was seen in this in our present case. We considered low-grade fibromyxoid sarcoma also as one of the differential, but they are quite unusual to occur in the head and neck region, and they mostly present with heavily collagenized zones with abrupt transition into myxoid nodules. So those features were really lacking, and they display some curvilinear pattern with blood vessels and walled arrangement of hypochromatic spindle nuclei. So all those features were not present. We went ahead with markers just to rule out if we are missing out on any of the spindle cell lesion. Vimentin was strongly positive with our tumor cells. To our surprise, beta-catenin was positive in most of the cells. They showed nuclear as well as cytoplasmic positivity. The tumor cells also showed positivity for SMA. Though the Ki-67 was very low, it was even less than 1%, and the tumor cells were completely negative for PAN-CK, CD56, myogenin desmin, STATX, so NSE, ALK, and SARBI2G almost ruled all the spindle cell lesions which could be possible in the oral cavity. So slowly we sort of ruled out. We also STATX and ALK negativity, we ruled out inflammatory fibroblastic tumor as well as solitary fibrous tumor. We were just left with the last one, the desmoid tumor or the desmoplastic fibroma. Of course, it was beta-catenin positive, which is again a marker for desmoplastic fibroma. Now, these lesions are locally aggressive myofibroblastic lesion of bone, and they are considered to be the mesenchymal tumor of intermediate malignancy or a borderline by WHO. They are also termed as desmoid tumor or the intraosseous counterpart of desmoid fibromatosis. 10% of fibromatosis, they occur in the head and neck region, and mostly they occur in less than 30 years, like approximately 85% cases they report in this age group. 86% of NATIC cases occur in mandible, mostly in ramus angle region. They are slow growing and painless lesions, and radiographically they present with well-defined and mostly do not show any mineralization. They are said to arise from mesenchymal stem cells within bone with differentiation towards fibroblasts and myofibroblasts, and they develop via CTNB1 hotspot mutations or APC mutations. Histologically, they could be infiltrative or permeative. They are richly collagenous stroma, and they show uniform fibroblasts with slender tapering nuclei with minimal or no atypia, and mitosis are quite rare. They can show perivascular edema and small capillaries with parallel alignment to the fascicles, which were actually also seen in our case. The reactive bone could be seen at the periphery of the desmoid tumor, which could be mistaken for osteoid production. So that was one of the reasons why I've included this particular case, because when we were dealing with this case, we were thinking in terms of fibrosis lesion, considering they are the most common ones to occur in the jaws, and when we saw a reactive bone, we sort of sometimes start thinking in terms of benign fibrosis lesions. So we have to think that, you know, it could be a periphery. So these desmoid tumors always show tubercular at the periphery, and that's something which differentiates from even osteosarcomas. The bony spicules are never an integral part of the lesion. They are never seen within the tumor area. So sampling, the sample should be sampled generously from the center rather than the periphery of the lesion. So taking the lesion from the periphery could be sometimes really troubling. Now, these cases are mostly positive for SMA in mostly 50% of cases, and MSA and Desmin can also be positive sometimes. Beta-catenin are positive in 50% of cases, and they show cytoplasmic positivity. Nuclear in these intraosseous parts is mostly uncommon, though our case was showed nuclear as well as cytoplasmic positivity. Ki-67 is mostly less than 1%. The treatment, they are mostly excised with clear margins, though the recurrence has been reported from varying from 5 to 20%, whereas if they are curated, they show higher recurrence ranging up to 30%. So coming to our next case, is a 26-year-old male patient who complained of a swelling in the lower jaw since 7 to 8 years. There was a bony hard swelling present on the left side of the inferior border of the mandible, and CECT can show the buccolingual expansion and the thinning of the cortical plate. When we saw the histology, there were some hypocellular stroma, wherein there were loose aggregates of spindle and stellate shaped cells with some chondromyxoid matrix, and surrounded by a hypercellular stroma with the ovoid or mesenchymal cells producing some homogeneous osteoid like matrix. So there were some abundant chondromyxoid matrix undergoing some calcification in few areas, and eosinophilic osteoid-like matrix in few areas. There were also some secondary aneurysmal bone cyst-like changes, some sinusoidal spaces with a lot of hemorrhagic areas. So we formed a differential considering a lot of cartilaginous differentiation, which we could appreciate in our slides. We kept ectomesenchymal chondromyxoid tumor as a first because it was really mimicking this particular case, but they have been only reported in the anterior tongue, and none of the case has been reported as an intraosseous ectomesenchyme variant. So we sort of cancelled the diagnosis based on the site. Then we considered chondroblastic osteosarcoma or chondrosarcoma, osteochondroma, chondroblastoma, and considering this intraosseous, we kept ontogenic myxoma and pleomorphic adenoma because it's intraosseous, and chondromyxoid fibroma as other differentials. We'll go one by one as per the cases we have seen so far. So coming to the chondroblastic osteosarcomas, which we saw were like an 8-year-old female child, and she presented with an osteolytic lesion with some sclerotic changes at the periphery. And if we talk about the histology, we see mostly the lobules and sheets of chondrocytes intermixed with the myxomatous areas. And these chondrocytes, if we see in the high part, they produce a lot of malignant cartilage, and they show a lot of ATPI in those chondrocytes with some loosely arranged stellate shaped cells. So this is the kind of picture which we saw in our histology. So we were confused with this particular case because it was also showing a cartilaginous pattern, but the ATPI which were seen mostly in the sarcomas were absent in our present case. There were few areas wherein the osteoid was also laid down along with the calcifications which were seen in the chondrocytes. And of course, there were a lot of osteoid matrix. And if we can just compare that, there were a lot of ATP or pleomorphism could be seen in a chondroblastic osteosarcoma. So none of these features were seen in our particular case. We did not appreciate any nuclear pleomorphism or ATP. or any malignant cartilaginous formation. We did appreciate cartilage, but we could not appreciate a cartilage, malignant cartilage like this. So we sort of cancelled the first one and the sarcomatous component, the chondroblastic osteosarcoma and even chondrosarcomas, which will again show some cytologic atypia, and even they can show hyaline cartilage, but again all those the atypia was not matching with the case. Coming to the next case of osteochondromas, which are considered to be more common in the jaw lesions, they're mostly seen in the mostly seen in with respect to the condyle, and we have seen mostly these cases. Like this was a 19-year-old female with facial asymmetry, and involving involving the condylar region, and the lower part of the mandible is sort of pushed downwards, and even CCT can help in appreciating the condyle hyperplasia. These cases show a very well-defined cartilage as well as the bone, and there's a widened cartilaginous cap comprising of chondrocytes in the lacunae covering the bony trabeculae with the fatty and hematopoietic marrow, and there will be a transition between properly formed cartilage with some endochondral ossification occurring into the bone and then a mature bone. So of course this was not this was really not matching with our particular case. Then coming to the chondroblastoma, which is very rare to occur in the oral cavity, especially in the jaws, and they show uniform proliferation of polygonal epithelioid cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, and they show many giant cells without extensive myxoid stroma. So our case showed a lot of myxomatous areas, so we sort of ruled out chondroblastoma as well as odontogenic myxomas, because we could not there were absolutely no odontogenic risks, and there were cartilaginous differentiation which is very unlike of odontogenic myxoma. Coming to a pleomorphic adenoma, we cancelled that because there were no salivary ductal structures or any epithelial structures which we could appreciate in our present case. So with that, I think so we have almost cancelled everything, and we just did SARBI2 just to identify whether they are the osteoblasts which we are looking into, and they were strongly positive. So considering the radiology, the intraosseous location, as well as the mixed pattern of hypocellular surrounded by hypercellular areas of chondromyxoid areas, we signed it out as a chondromyxoid fibroma. Now these tumors are very rare, and they are benign cartilaginous tumors. They are less than 1% of all primary bone tumors. They frequently show abnormalities in chromosome 6. Mostly they are seen in metaphyses of long bones, and craniofacially only 2% cases have been reported, and the mandible is the most common site. They're mostly seen in second to third decades, and clinically the patient presents with swelling, mostly presents in mandible, with a well circumscribed radiolucency, and occasionally with radiopacities, sometimes with sclerotic or scalloped border. Histologically, they can show lobular proliferation of spindle stellate cells in a myxoid stroma, with center being hypocellular and the periphery being hypocellular. So very characteristic histological features they have. They can show epithelioid cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, and multinucleated giant cells can also be seen. Most of these cases can show entrapped residual osteoid, so they do mimic fibrosis lesions a lot. Now myxoid stroma is found to be positive for type 2 collagen, and SOX9 has been found to be positive for spindle and stellate cells. Now these cases are quite rare, and they are mostly excised, and the recurrence part as far as jaw lesions is concerned, there are not much literature regarding the same. Coming to our next case is a 57-year-old female. She had a small swelling in the lower jaw since 25 years, and which has progressed to the present size. And similar lesion is also present in the right tibia, and the alkaline phosphatase was quite increased, and even the PTS levels were quite raised, you know. The radiology showed the expansion of the mandible and involving the body, ramus region, and also the condyle, with the heterogeneous densities and regions of some ground glass internal matrix. We could also appreciate some cotton wool-like radio opacities. This is the NCCT phase, just to show how the what exactly was the extent of expansion of the mandible. Now, the histologically, the lesion showed a cell of fibrosis lesion with ostea trabeculae, exhibiting a osteoblastic rimming in most of the areas, with osteoclastic some resorptive lacuna in few areas, and there were a few multinucleated giant cells and a lot of resting and reversal lines of lamellar bone, with haphazardly arranged into a mosaic pattern. This case we have signed out as a Paget's disease. It's quite a classic one. I'm sure it's quite easy to diagnose. Now, they're also called as osteitis deformis. These entities are also termed as osseous dysplasias, which are characterized by rapid turnover or remodeling of bone throughout the skeleton. And the classic Paget's disease of bone, it's a disease of the elderly, unlike the fibrous dysplasia. Now, two Paget's-like bone dysplasias that can arise during childhood are the juvenile Paget's disease or idiopathic hyperphosphatasemia, as well as the familial expansile osteolysis. They mostly result from defective function of osteoprotectin pathway and a molecular regulator of osteoclastogenesis. The tubular bones, they show bowing and spinal curvature with the vertebral collapse at later stages in these patients. And they also report with markedly elevated serum alkaline phosphatase. So their clinical and radiology are quite distinctive, so which really helps in sort of diagnosing these entities. Mostly they exhibit a ground glass trabecular pattern in early stage disease with progression or diffuse sclerosis, radiographically yielding the so-called cotton wool appearance of the confluent nodular opacifications. Now, when we talk about the pagetoid heritable bone dysplasias of childhood, so as the Paget's disease of elderly, there have been this variant has been seen in the juvenile cases, which is termed as juvenile Paget's disease or idiopathic hyperphosphatasemia. The other variant is the familial expansile osteolysis. Juvenile Paget's disease is autosomal recessive, whereas the familial expansile osteolysis is autosomal dominant. Juvenile Paget's is seen mostly in infancy and early childhood. They show serum alkaline phosphatase, they are elevated. Now, whereas if we talk about the familial expansile osteolysis, they occur mostly slightly in adolescence in the second decade. Both of them show elevated serum alkaline phosphatase, so that is something which is similar with the Paget's disease. Juvenile Paget's shows long bone widening with propensity for pathologic fracture and thickening of the skull. And they have extremely rapid bone turnover, causing osteopenia and skeletal bone deformity with bowed limbs. Whereas when we talk about familial expansile osteolysis, they show osteoclastic resorption with cancellous bone expansion. There's an early tooth loss, so we do see dental defects in these cases by external resorption. Also these patients report with deafness because of the cycle agenesis. Now they show a fibrosis pattern with extensive remodeling of woven bone, focal collections of multinucleated giant cells, and the presence of viral-like inclusions are also seen in familial type. So coming to our next case is a six-year-old male with a bony heart swelling on the left side of the jaw since 6 months. So this is a CCT showing the expansion. When we saw the gross, the patient, the cut surface had a curvilinear hemorrhagic pattern on the strands. Histology, it revealed a very varied pattern. Few areas showed a well-circumscribed and you know, hypercellular connective tissue comprising of loose collagen fibers interspersed with some irregular bony tubercle with some osteoblastic rimming around. Then there were also some osteoclastic like joint cells, and then there were a lot of fibrocellular areas with a lot of osteoclastic joint cells, and then there were some osteoid matrix which was adjacent to those particular irregular strands of osteoid matrix which were undergoing calcifications, and most of those areas were showing osteoblastic rimming. So as we went to the hyper, there were clusters of multinucleated joint cells interspersed with abundant you know, areas of hemorrhage also, and some osteoid matrix with entrapment of osteoblasts, and looked quite aggressive lesion to us. These are the again the osteoid matrix with quite active osteoblasts, the osteocytes which were within the lacunae pattern, and they were quite active osteoblasts surrounding these irregular bony tubercle. But of course, there was no atypia, or we could not appreciate any increased mitosis. Though the Ki-67 was quite high, it was somewhere around 15%. We were thinking in terms of the low-grade osteosarcoma, so we did MD, M2 and CDK4. It was all negative. There was no malignant osteoid or nuclear pleomorphism or cytological atypia to call it as any high-grade osteosarcoma. So we were just sort of thinking in terms of maybe a aggressive form of juvenile ossifying fibroma, or because the age was, the patient is young, and as well as we were thinking in terms of low-grade osteosarcoma, so it was ruled out. We went back to, is there some other entity, because we were really not convinced to call it still after getting a negative MDM2 CDK4. We were not convinced to call it as a juvenile ossifying fibroma. So we went into the literature, we looked into hybrid cases, and we saw that there were few hybrid central joints and granulomas, and 10 cases have been reported so far which were associated with fibrosis entities. Central giant cell granuloma has been, like majority of the cases have been found associated with ossifying fibromas. Three cases have been found associated with fibrous dysplasias, though our case was a well-defined lesion, so we ruled out fibrous dysplasias. One case was reported with a cementitious dysplasia. Of course, it was a well-defined, quite an aggressive lesion, definitely not a cementitious dysplasia. So after excluding all the other entities, we signed it out as a juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma with central giant cell granuloma. So there has been a hypothesis again with these hybrid lesions, and Shetty et al. have proposed that it could be a coincidental finding or a reactive process rather than a feature of a separate lesion. Then there have been investigators who have proposed that the osteoblast may activate osteoclast type joint cells through paracrine mechanisms, which could lead to this kind of, two entities showing together in histology. And now there are two varied opinions whether juvenile ossifying fibromas had developed as in central position first and then initiated a adjacent giant cell reaction, or whether two lesions originated independently. So they're more of academic interest, but because of the rarity or a very small number of these cases, their biologic behavior is really uncertain. So is their treatment. So as of now, the patient is under follow-up and has not shown any recurrence. So coming to our last case, is a 10-year-old boy who presented with a mild swelling in the right posterior alveolus region for 6 to 7 months, and he presented with a large expansile well-defined multilocular radiolucent lesion with thin internal pony tubercle and corticated margins in the right ramus and posterior body of the mandible. It has caused displacement of right lower second molar and is associated with the lower third molar. When we saw the NCCT face, there was a well-defined lytic lesion with the internal bony tubercle and corticated margins in the right ramus and posterior body of the mandible. Histology revealed a very varied appearance. It showed a dense fibrocellular stroma showing degenerated bony tubercle with few dystrophic calcifications, and we have never seen such kind of calcifications in any of our fibrosis entities so far. And there were a lot of hemorrhagic areas which were seen. We again went into hyper. There were a lot of dystrophic calcifications. And any of you, if you have ever reported such calcification, please write to me, because this is we have just checked with our experts, and even none of them have also seen these kind of calcifications. We initially were thinking in terms of any, infections, like maybe, so we did pass and we ruled out any fungal as well as any mycobacterial infections. So there were a few areas wherein it showed multinucleated giant cells, so which were found associated with these calcifications. So mimicking more like osteoclasts. So there were a lot of areas of RBC extravasations as well as adjacent calcifications which were there. A lot of areas of hemorrhage, and again calcified material undergoing calcification. So we made a differential, though we kept our ontogenic myxoma, because sometimes it also showed a very varied appearance, but that was more of a radiological differential. When we saw the histology, it was completely not mimicking ontogenic myxoma, so we ruled that out. Aneurysmal bone cyst and cementosifying fibromas were something which we are still considering, because it was showing a lot of sinusoidal spaces, so was mimicking aneurysmal bone cyst, so we couldn't rule that out, and same with the cemento ossifying fibroma because of the ossifications which we could see in this particular entity. We went ahead and we did KI67 just to be doubly sure if we are just dealing with a benign and not something which is rarely, again very rare. So it was very low, almost negative. SADB2 was also not contributing in our present case. So we signed it out as a cemento ossifying fibroma with aneurysmal bone cyst. Now 13 cases have been reported so far, and 6 cases are reported in the jaws, out of which 5 cases were in mandible, as was our case, and 1 was in maxilla. Again, the kind of histology which we saw in this was really sort of different from the ones which we normally see in the ossifying fibromas. But that was the most suitable diagnosis which we could think of. We did a 2-year follow-up of this patient, and the patient is doing well with absolutely no recurrence. So to conclude, I would say whenever we are dealing with these fibrosis lesions, a consultation with the radiologist can be very helpful. A biopsy should include the interface between lesional and normal adjacent tissue, and pertinent radiographic information is really necessary to sign out these cases. Achieving an accurate final diagnosis is of primordial importance, since it will decide what kind of treatment the patients would receive. For example, if we talk about ossifying fibromas, they need to be completely surgically excised, and they require a rapid or aggressive action, especially the juvenile ossifying fibromas, because they really grow fast and has a local aggressive pattern, and they can show a recurrence. Whereas if we talk about osseous dysplasias, therein no intervention is required, and similar with the fibrous dysplasia, wherein just the recontouring is required. So we really need to work out for the right diagnosis. So I would like to say that the clinical, radiologic and histopathologic data is really essential. Just to sum up, we discussed about the juvenile ossifying fibromas, how they could be sometimes really challenging in terms of they could be, as in our present case, wherein we saw multiple ossifying fibromas in a young patient, and associated with some familial cases also. Then fibrous dysplasias, which can again, and those sometimes they're quite easy but require a definitive diagnosis, because there are sometimes a differential which needs to be ruled out, especially the polyostotic ones, wherein whenever you deal with multiple lesions, they are the entities which, and multiple, and especially the young patient, we need to first consider this entity and has to rule out. Coming to the cemento-osseous dysplasias, these cases, though radiologically they are mostly diagnosed on the radiology and clinically, and they mostly we encounter them with accidentally with on a routine radiograph, but sometimes they can mimic other entities. So whenever they mimic other entities, they are required to be biopsied and looked into. And then we talked about Brown's tumor or hyperparathyroidism, wherein whenever you deal with some multiple fibrosis lesions, those are the things which should raise an alarm, that could it be some central giant cell granuloma kind lesions or giant cell lesions wherein multiple sites are involved, like hyperparathyroidism. Now, we also discussed about the low-grade osteosarcomas, which could be very challenging at times and can mimic your juvenile ossifying fibromas or aggressive osteoblastomas. So it really becomes very important to take the help of certain markers and serial sections to just get some hint regarding the histology, and also those are the cases wherein the markers really help. We discussed about some of the very rare entities which can show present in the jaws and can sometimes mimic benign fibrosis lesions, like the desmoid tumor of bone or the chondromyxoid tumors, which are quite rare but have a very characteristic appearance. Now then the Paget's disease of bone, of course they are quite characteristic in their histology and radiological features, but still we always need to consider those entities whenever we are talking about fibrosis lesions. Then we also need to keep it in our mind that, nothing comes, every case could be different. So sometimes you can deal with some challenging or some hybrid lesions. So we should be knowing that sometimes these entities can come together, like the juvenile trabecular type with central giant cell granuloma, or like the ossifying fibroma with the aneurysm and bone cyst. So I think so. A holistic approach is really important for a pathologist when we are dealing with these fibrosis lesions, and we really need to look into the radiology. And it's really important that we should not miss out the radiological features before we sign out these cases. I would like to acknowledge my teachers, my mentors, and my clinicians who have been kind enough in sharing with us their specimens and the clinical and radiological features. Our pathologists who have always given their expert opinion whenever we are dealing with these rare entities. Our radiological experts who have, and I would say that we at our center would never sign out these fibrosis lesions without having a consultation with radio diagnosis people. Last but the most important ones are my senior residents, who have really helped me in dealing with these cases, because they are the ones who have gone running around to get the radiology or the clinical features or sometimes the opinion from different experts for these cases. And of course, I would like to again thank my technicians and attendants who were really kind enough to give us the good sections. These are my references, and I would like to just say that in this, a very nice saying that life is so much brighter when we focus on what truly matters. I know it's really, it's very true for life, especially when it comes, when in these COVID times, we really need to focus on what truly matters to us. But it's also applicable for these entities. So we always had to focus on really some very important factors, and we need to take a proper history, and we should not be missing the radiology of these patients also. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepika. Wonderful. Wow. Absolutely correct. Life is so much important. You know, it really matters and everything matters in that. And what you rightly said as you were summarizing that this entire entity, whatever it is a combination of radiology, clinical picture, as well as histology. And no one person can take the credit out of the whole thing. And it's a teamwork which really matters. Thank you for acknowledging all the team members. Very few people do that. It's so nice on your part to do that. Excellent presentation as usual. Wonderful cases, very nicely done. Very hard work you have really put in to teach everybody. Thank you. There are some questions and there are many more comments than questions. So first I would like to go what Dr. Ipshita Dhal wants you. Ma'am, can you please advise a good textbook on oral pathology? To the point.
I would say that oral whenever we are dealing with the oral pathology, first of all we should try to pick up few more few different authors so that it becomes really more interesting when we are dealing with different books. I would not say that I even for this these cases we read at one entity from at least three textbooks. But yes, if you want really to the point, I would say I've been following Schaeffer's from my very training time and Neville, and as we grew then we started following Sukhbin Wu. Again, when we started seeing these rare entities, we picked up head and neck pathology textbooks, so Thompson and Venig, and you know, have written very concise book together wherein they have put all the you know, points. And of course there has been a books by Thompson and Bishop with, and also Atlas of Venig. So I think so they are really good books which you can really go back into. And I think so there are other books also which I go back to, like Cawson and Odell, which I really love that book. So it's very difficult for me to just pinpoint and tell you one book. But yes, if you are just beginning as a trainee, you can start pick up a Schaeffer's and a Neville to build up your concepts, and then can go slowly.
Great. Yeah, I think that's absolutely correct. No one book can suffice. But yes, to start with, Schaeffer's is a very nice book, right? There is another question by Dr. Akshay Bhargav. He says, good evening, ma'am. Why cherubism is not considered as a differential diagnosis in the case of brown tumor?
Okay. First of all, when we talk about cherubism, mostly seen in, you know, younger patients, the children, and we remember that cherub baby's face. So that is something very classic. So those cherub babies, so they have those very typical features of bilateral involvement of the mandible involving the condyle, sort of sparing the condyle sometimes. And this present case was not a young patient, was an elderly patient, and they had bilateral mandible along with the clavus. Now cherubism would be just limited to bilateral mandible. This patient reported and has undergone biopsy from all the three sites, so were reporting with the symptoms and signs. So that's one of the reason why we never thought of cherubism at all, maybe because of the age factor. But yes, if we talk about histology, it could mimic, because cherubism again shows a very vague histological pattern. But yes, they do show storiform around the blood vessels. That's also something which was missing in our case. So yes, so we sort of ruled that out, but we never considered that considering the age.
Right. Excellent. Absolutely true. Now we will just go to some of the comments, and I'm waiting for Dr. Aravinda has a question, but I think he can unmute his mic and ask the question directly. Dr. Aravinda Babu, you can unmute your mic and ask the question. Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, very good presentation. I just want to introduce myself, Professor Aravind Babu, Department Head from Chennai, sir. I have two questions to you. One is, what is the role of hormone in fibrous dysplasia? And treatment part, we were thinking we'll wait until adolescence, until puberty. What is your concept regarding the role of hormones in fibroblasts, basically? Hormonal role.
Hormonal role.
Either male hormone or female hormone. Why we have to wait till this?
Okay. So if I got it correct, what is the role of hormones in fibrous dysplasia? Is that your question? Or why is it seen?
Yes. For planning treatement. For planning treatment, we are waiting till puberty.
So first of all, what they have seen is that these fibrous dysplasias have a very typical pattern of the what happens is till puberty they can increase in size, and immediately after the after the puberty they sometimes can show slight regression, or they sort of regress, or sometimes they stop at the same time, and that is the time when they are the ones which when they are treated. So that's one of the reasons why we have to sort of stop in terms of the treatment aspect. As far as hormonal, I think so it's mostly because this is mostly an anomaly wherein abnormality wherein the normal fibrous tissue is being replaced by the bony tissue in an altered way. So what happens because there has been a lot of hormonal surge in those in during puberty, so they can affect and they can grow. So if you treat them before the puberty, they can again recur and would require again a surgical intervention later on. So it's always better, especially in the adults, to delay the treatment after the puberty so that the growth has occurred and whatever the fibrous dysplasia has to attain its size would attain, and after that they are not supposed to be treated, they are supposed to be just recontoured because of the rare malignant transformation which has been reported in these cases. So the surgical intervention is mostly avoided. And only the contouring is advised for these cases.
Yes, madam. Very nice explanation, madam. Whether this thing suits for other fibrosis patients or only fibrous dysplasia?
Okay, this stands only for fibrous dysplasia. In fact, for these fibrosis lesions, when we talk about all these fibrosis lesions are to be treated in a different way and are to be dealt in a different way. That's why the correct diagnosis really becomes very important. For example, as I told that in cementitious dysplasia, they are not to be touched till you are suspecting they are focal type and you are suspecting some other entity, maybe a neoplastic or inflammatory as etiology, and you want to rule that out so that a proper treatment could be initiated. Only then osseous dysplasia, that too just a focal type, is biopsied. Otherwise, if on radiology or the patient does not present with clinical, even osseous dysplasia are not to be treated. As in cases of fibrous dysplasia, we have already discussed not to be treated other than just the bone contouring. Same with the Paget's disease. They are only to be surgically contoured only if they are sort of causing any hindrance to the patient, or they require some different kind of they complain, yes, and just a contouring is required. Whereas if we talk about ossifying fibromas, they are the aggressive ones, they are the neoplasms, so they require surgical intervention and has to be treated as soon as possible so that they, because of the aggressive nature, they can invade or they can progress to the adjacent structures causing more destruction. So they need surgical intervention as soon as possible, be it cemento ossifying or juvenile type. And then the other mimics of fibrosis lesions also need to be first diagnosed and then has to be treated accordingly. For example, few of the authors do consider cherubism, like how one of us were asking that. And so cherubism can also be considered. So again, cherubism is not to be treated. So all these fibrosis lesions has to be first diagnosed, and then accordingly the treatment varies for those entities.
Excellent. I'll come back with some more doubts through your mail. I don't want to waste time. Thanks a lot.
Sure. You can write to me on my mail ID if you have any doubt.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I'll just read out the comments. You know, Dr. Soumya SV says, excellent presentation, Dr. Deepika. Dr. Achala Bharti, again an excellent presentation, ma'am. Always waiting to hear from you. Dr. Vivek Gupta, very nice presentation, especially when the differential diagnosis was explained. Thank you for taking so much effort in explaining different entities. Looking forward for more. I can't agree more for that. Then we have Dr. Ipsita Dhal. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your wonderful presentation. Cases were very interesting and useful. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Aravind Babu, for attending this lecture and for being a part of this wonderful, you know, session. We welcome you here, sir. Wonderful presentation, Dr. Deepika. Excellently done. I bet you must be really tired. Two very long and very interesting presentations in just a matter of 3 days. You know, really, you need some rest and very good stamina. Thank you so much. I would request you to please share the PDF so that we can share it on the Google Drive so that everybody can access that. We'll be uploading the edited version of this entire recording by tomorrow morning, so everybody can view that on our YouTube channel. And any more questions, they can ask directly to ma'am. Her email ID is available for everybody to ask. She would reply back directly. Thank you so much, everybody. Please, God bless you all. Thank you. Good night. Take care. Bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye. Thank you.